bleeding purple and gold. From the heart of Los Angeles, this is the LakersNation.com podcast with your host, Trevor Lane.
Welcome to today's show. As always, we are powered by CLNS Media and LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. And speaking of Lakers Nation, right now you can follow Lakers Nation on Apple News completely ad-free for the entire month of October, so make sure you guys go check this out. Today's show is brought to you by Lightstream, DraftKings, and Eero. We'll talk a little bit more about them later. But first, today we've brought in Chris Geeter Mcgee from Spectrum Sportsnet to talk a little bit about the upcoming Lakers season starting up in just a few days. One of my favorite people to talk Lakers basketball with. Geeter, thanks so much for hopping on.
What's going on, Trevor? Happy to be on, man, and excited for a brand new season of Laker basketball. Cannot wait for this to get started.
Oh, man. I mean, games are starting, and games that count, games that matter, and finally the Lakers are in a position where people are expecting them to win again.
Yeah, I know. That's a lot different feeling than we've had around here in a long time. Man, is that a nice expectation to have.
Hey, you were around at practice today. What's the mood like around there with these guys? Is it just optimism abound, or what's the feeling?
Yeah, for sure. But it's not like fake optimism. You know, I think when everyone starts a new year, right, there's just like this renewed hope, and everyone walks the walk and talks the talk. Mm-hmm. I don't feel with these veterans it's like that. They go about their business. When asked how people are or how they're doing, they're very honest about it. And I kind of like that. But it's definitely a cool vibe around there, like this professionalism, this, you know, goal of being a team that can contend and all that kind of stuff that goes with it. You know, we it was weird the past few years just kind of worrying more about what your draft slot was going to be than, you know, where your playoff seat's going to be. So it's definitely a different feel. There is confidence in the room for sure, but there's also a lot of question marks still because no one's seen this team in action yet. And I think that's what the veterans bring to the table. Trevor, really, to be honest with you, they've been through this before. They understand it. They get it. So they're not coming out saying, hey, we're going to be great. We're going to go 8-2 first 10 games. They know this is going to be a process and there's going to be some up and down moments. I mean, LeBron has told everyone that. So, that's what having good vets around means for this Laker team. You know, you're not going to get ahead of yourself, and you got to be patient.
Right. I mean, they've been preaching patience for a while now, trying to lower the expectations. People are expecting, or at least some are expecting, this team to come flying out of the gates. I've been saying, man, if they're 10-10 in the first 20 games, I'd be happy with that, given all the new faces they have to integrate. That's not an easy task.
No, it's not an easy task. And I don't blame Laker fans either. I mean, you and I are fans, but we're around it a lot more and probably look at it from a different angle. But listen, they're, you know, you get the greatest player in the world, the expectation rises. You get a Rondo and the expectations rise. Your young guys are a year older and all of a sudden people start to you know, to talk about what's to come and playoffs and can they contend with the Warriors. And I think you really, when you look at the makeup of the team and the roster, you go, okay, well hold on. It's going to take some time. When LeBron had three Hall of Famers with him, you know, Dwayne Wade, Chris Bosh, and him, they started 9-9 or something. So you do have to be patient. Those first 10 games are brutal, man. And, man, I'd really love 6-4. I would be ecstatic with 7-3, you know, if 4-8-2, I'm doing backflips. But those first three games right out of the gate alone, at Portland, Houston at home, San Antonio, and you turn around, you're going to go to Portland again later. Toronto's coming to you, at San Antonio, Denver. I mean, that's a brutal first 10 games.
It's a rough stretch. I mean, the NBA schedule makers certainly didn't do the Lakers any favors in the early going of the season. Of course, the schedule does ease up a little bit as they get a little further into it. You know, you mentioned that the veterans are the guys kind of keeping the expectations low, keeping the guys grounded, or at least as realistically low as they can be. But then I saw a comment today, and it was Rajon Rondo, and he's talking to Kevin Ding of the Lakers. And he was asked about the Lakers organization compared to the Celtics and all these other great organizations he's been part of.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I'm standing right there.
He says, I can't say it's not the best organization I've ever played for. Is that, I mean, to me, that stuck out like a sore thumb compared to everything they've been doing to kind of lower the expectations and keep people from getting too crazy here. What do you make of that?
You know, it's funny. I was outside the scrum because I wasn't in it today asking questions. So I was kind of listening and tweeting and talking to some other people and talked to Josh Hart off to the side. And ironically, I got a tweet today from somebody saying that I need to be better at questions and heckling me. But by the way, that wasn't me. The guy's already apologized, but it's just amazing. Side story right there. But it was funny because Bill Orme came over to me and showed me that quote because he was tweeting it out. And he's like, he's basically saying it's the best team he's played for, right? Like best organization. And I'm like, yeah, that's kind of what it sounds like. So we actually had a discussion about that. I think coming from Rondo, that is, tell you what, it says a lot about the Laker organization. It really speaks to what they've built in the last 2 years under Luke Walton, in my opinion. Bringing in Robin Magic, the guys that they've drafted, props to Jesse Buss and all the scouts, the people they've brought in, the people that maybe sadly they've let go that maybe fans weren't that happy about. They've created a group and a culture that they're going to roll with, and they're building, and they've done it one step at a time. And for a guy like Rondo, who's been basically everywhere, to kind of come in and talk about how the organization treats players and people, that was really nice to hear, to be honest with you. He wasn't just throwing it out there. He meant it. That's not Rondo's style. I think that's why it sticks out to me, and maybe you. You know, Rondo just doesn't throw out compliments like that unless he means it. I mean, he will let you know the truth. So I'm like you. I was pretty fired up to hear that.
I mean, I suppose the caution here is that we are still in the honeymoon phase. I mean, I'm sure Rondo's going to have plenty of prickly comments as the season goes on. But I mean, that was glowing praise, and I feel like from a Lakers fan perspective, the fact that his main success came as a Boston Celtic, and now he's saying that just makes it that much nicer, I think.
Well, yeah, there's no doubt about it. And I mean, listen, I mean, think back to all the wars we had with Rondo when you were a fan and whatever. I mean, just couldn't stand him. And he was just so annoying and stealing balls and disrupting your offense and those long arms, those big hands. And here he is in a Laker uniform and he's praising the Laker organization. But you hit on something, you know, that honeymoon stage. I think that to me, I think as I've gotten older and I've been around this business long enough, and I think back to when I played, you have to be aware of that, because I'm glad you brought it up, because when things are in the beginning and things are new, there's a great feeling. It's like any relationship, right? You can't wait to go to work. It's when you go through some stuff, man, that you really learn about each other, and how you get through that stuff really is what you build your identity off of, than what you become. And that defines you in the end. I mean, that's not easy. And if it's too wrong, right? Like there's a line or it's going to go bad at some point. So it's okay to figure things out. Times loose, not this guy's trash. Let's fire the coach, this and that. Let's see how it unfolds, man. Let's give it some time and let's really see what this team can do. That's what I love about building a team. So
it's going to be interesting to see how all the guys adjust as the season goes on. And this is what I think actually is one of Luke's biggest challenges, because you've got guys like Rondo, like LeBron, who are so great at being the coach out there on the floor. But if things start to go south, you also have a lot of guys that are on 1 year deals that could start to play a very me first brand of basketball as they look to their next contract. So I think balancing that is going to be a challenge for Luke, and trying to keep everybody positive and therefore sharing the ball and doing the kinds of things that you need to do on the offensive end.
And think about this. We were talking about this today. Josh Hart, Lonzo, KCP, Rondo. When you get to the end of games, two of those guys are out, right?
Right. Well, you know what? I didn't mind seeing the Rondo Lonzo combo.
So either did I for sure. But two of those guys is out.
Most likely, yeah.
Two of those four are going to be out. So, you know, that's going to create something. I mean, I feel like, you know, obviously that changes from time to time. And, you know, maybe someone's got the hot hand, you go with them. But for me, and the reason why I bring this up is that, you know, that also creates some noise outside, and how they deal with that internally and how guys are, you know, how guys feel about their roles is important for teams. Think about great teams. And I think this is so underrated in every sport. Best teams, everyone knows their roles. We don't know roles yet. The Lakers don't know their roles yet. it takes time to figure that out. Like, who's your guy that can get buckets off the bench? Who's your defensive stopper? Who's your guy that he knows he's going in the end of that fourth quarter, or he's going to be a part of it? Who's that guy that knows he's probably coming in mid third, early fourth, but he's not finishing? And is he okay with that? So they got to figure all that stuff out, Trevor. And that, to me, is a great part of it, but it's also a challenging part for Luke and that staff and for everybody.
We're going to pause for just 1 second here to talk about fantasy sports and DraftKings. Now, basketball season is finally back. The season is starting up, and you know what that means. It's time to put your basketball knowledge to the test with one-day fantasy basketball at DraftKings. DraftKings is giving away over $400 million in prizes this season. That's more than 10 times what Los Angeles is paying the king himself. No matter what your skill level is, there's a contest waiting for you at DraftKings. Drafting your team is simple. Select 8 players and stay under the $50,000 salary cap. Earn points when your players score, assist, block, rebound, and more. The best part is you get to draft a new team every day without any commitment. And really, the draft is one of the most fun parts of the fantasy season. So you get to do that every day. It's amazing. There's no better way to turn your love of basketball into cash. Download the app or head over to DraftKings.com now and use my code LAKERS to support the show and play free with your first deposit. And remember, there will be $400 million in total prizes up for grabs throughout the season. That's my code LAKERS to play for free with your first deposit only at DraftKings. Minimum $5 deposit. Eligibility restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com for details.
Yeah, it's going to be a learning experience. It's going to take time for them to grow together. I've had people asking, how long is it going to take this team to really gel, right? And I don't think it's even something where you can say 2 months, 3 months. Realistically, this group, for them to grow together, we're talking years for them to truly hit their peak basketball.
Yeah, for sure.
It's going to be a process. And as the veterans have been saying, we need to kind of walk back the expectations a little bit, especially in the early going as they do figure things out. But at the same time, you gotta love this group that's been put together and just the competitiveness of them. And I think that these vets like Rondo and Lance and JaVale McGee, these guys are gonna do a great job as far as keeping these young guys on track. And I think that's part of the brilliance when everybody was ripping the Lakers for not adding enough shooting. Maybe, but they've also added on a lot of vets that can really help lead the way and show these young guys what it means to win.
Yeah, it wasn't just, hey, let's get these guys and have everyone completely question it from the national media and be baffled at why we did it. There's a plan. They don't need to share it with anybody. There's a vision and there's a reason why certain people are there. I might not get it. You might not get it, but that's not for us to get, right? Like, we just got to roll with who's there. And I think Luke's the same way, right? Like, this is the hand you're given. These are the guys we're rolling with. It's your job, and you get paid a lot of money to figure it out. And that's what's so great about Luke. Like, when you ask him about challenges, he says, I don't see it as a challenge. I see it as an opportunity. Like, he's the guy for that. Like, he appreciates the opportunity to coach a LeBron James, to figure out a way to integrate Lance Stephenson, right? Like, he loves that opportunity. And that's where I think the fun comes out as a coach. And you know what's funny? We talk about patience and all that. It's like, and then you see LeBron James play, and you're like, but God, he's so good. Isn't that worth how many wins? I mean, it's such a joke, right?
it kind of erases any problems that you're going to have. I mean, you can think, gosh, this could break down. This play may not work just right. But then when you've got LeBron out there, he kind of erases a lot of the little mistakes that the other guys can make just with his brilliance. So it's going to be so much fun to watch them out there. And, you've been watching the games like I have. I'm sure you've rewatched games like I've been doing and trying to dissect all the different plays and everything. What have you seen so far, whether it's in practice or during the games, I guess, that's really impressed you about this team and what they've done up to this point?
When they look good defensively, and my biggest question marks, I'm not sure if that's what we're going to get to soon, have been defensively, especially with that second unit and kind of that lack of, lack of kind of backup big, really, and kind of that right. Bully presence. But when I see them clicking, those top 7-8 guys, I love the length and the versatility defensively. And when they're really getting after it, that ability to get steals, blocks, rebounds, and they're gone. And that there's like 3, 4, 5 playmakers on every unit that can bring the ball up and dish. That to me is amazing. It's like, I mean, I've looked at James and these guys while we were watching these games sometimes, and I go, I don't know what's going to happen, but this is going to be fun. We're going to have some really fun nights. And I felt that way during the preseason. Now, offensively, to answer your question, yeah, I'm like everybody else too, where it's like, okay, well, do we have enough shooting? Like, man, you really need Josh Hart and Kuz and VI and all these guys to shoot better. But man, the one thing I noticed, the high IQ guys that they have on this team, the spacing and just the extra pass and getting to the corner because you know it's going to open up a lane, and the split screens and the drop passes and pocket passes and all these things that happen, I just go, man, this is special. It's a special group of players, and when they're all clicking, it's going to be remarkable. It really is.
I can tell you what I love. You mentioned all the passing and the, you know, the way they've been running the floor. What I love is that if they're making a mistake on the break, it's that they're overpassing. I mean, how often can you say that about an NBA team that guys aren't pulling the trigger? This is a stats-driven league, a league where you make money by putting the ball in the basket, and this team is probably passing too much, where if anything, they need to be a little bit more selfish. I think that's a great sign.
Yeah, it was really funny when Luke said after the game, I think they were kind of messing with me because it was just too many passes. So I like that. You know, I'm with you. It's like it just goes to show their, you know, unselfish style, how they want to please each other, how it kind of shows what their makeup is. I mean, listen, when the Warriors were really getting rolling, there were times I would watch and I would say they just made 3 extra passes there they didn't need to make, right? Like giving up wide open layups right. So they can swing the ball 3 times and get a 3. And then you started to see that, man, that's by design, and that's just by who they are, and that's just what they do. Like, I didn't mean by design, it's more like improv, right? Like you just go and make this pass and it's going to lead to another one, and I don't care about a layup, let's go for a 3. And you know, we're that good and we're that special and we're that unselfish, and it's really fun to watch. And I saw glimpses of that. I'm not comparing the Lakers to the Warriors, but I saw a glimpse of that where I was like, man, this team just has like really unselfish players on it that really like to share the ball. And that to me equals fun. And I know Luke loves to play that way.
Yeah. It's that read and react that they're so good at. And yeah. I think that once they get on the same page, we're going to see that become even more efficient. Whereas the too many passes, we won't see as much. We're going to see the pass, and then a bucket. Like, in the first game against the Golden State Warriors, they covered the length of the floor in 4 seconds off of a Klay Thompson made 3. And it was,
wasn't that great?
Oh, it was amazing. It was what? Lonzo to BI to LeBron lobbed the JaVale and the ball's in the basket. That was insane. I mean, that showed you right there. That was a flash of what this team can be and the types of plays they can make once they get going. So it's like people look at this group and they say, Luke has all these problems. He's got, you know, he's got this deep roster. He's got all these guys that deserve minutes. He's got all these issues to try to figure out. There's so many playmakers, only one ball. That's true to an extent, but I look at this team and I see not really problems, but good problems. I mean, there's a lot of good problems to have. There are a lot of teams that would kill to have the problems that the Lakers have right now.
Yeah, and I think Luke looks at it exactly like you do. Like I remember, you know, someone saying to him, a month ago, weird roster. And he goes, I love weird. You know what I mean? Like, look at it like that. Like, this is a great problem for a coach to have. 2 pass first point guards, a superstar who's a top 3 player of all time who actually likes to make the right basketball play and pass the ball and make those rounds better. Like, it's pretty amazing the character of this team and just the personality of this team. And like you said, I mean, when you have too many of those guys, man, that's a beautiful thing for a coach. So, by the way, you mentioned that play in 4 seconds. I was just laughing. I wanted to jump in and tell you Pete might have put that on Twitter or broke it down with a video. I remember Laker Film Room, and it was just so funny watching. Like, even the Warriors were like, wait, what? I mean, Kerr called timeout. Kerr doesn't call timeouts in preseason, but it was like the Lakers were faster than them almost.
Oh yeah, it was. I was trying to compare it to something, and I was thinking, you know, we're all in baseball mode right now with the Dodgers and everything, and
yeah.
You know, I'm keeping an eye on the Dodgers game right now as we're.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, you and I aren't supposed to date things, but we just missed a double down the line for a run to tie the game at 1, and I'm freaked out.
That's huge news. I don't have the TV on, so I didn't get to see it. I'm just, you know, updating the score online, yeah. So it is tied at 1 now.
Awesome. No. He just missed. We just missed a double down the line. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, anyway, I was trying to compare it to something else that we're all looking at. The average home run to leave the park takes between 4 to 6 seconds, and four is like if somebody really crushes a line drive, right? So the Lakers got the ball the entire length of the floor with four players touching it and put it in the basket before a normal home run leaves the park.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
It was just incredible, amazing.
Yeah,
stuff.
That's actually a really cool stat. That's a really cool stat.
So one of the things I want to ask you is something that came out of practice today was that it looks like the starting unit right now is Rondo, KCP, Brandon Ingram, LeBron, and JaVale McGee, right? So Rondo and KCP were kind of the question marks in there. Some people were arguing for Josh Hart and Lonzo Ball.
Yeah.
What do you think? Is that the way you would have gone with the starting five? Maybe that's it. We don't know for sure.
Yeah. I think it's an easier way to start the year because, listen, Lonzo has played in two preseason games in 196 days. So I'm okay with him coming off the bench and him getting in game shape and him not having the weight of the world on his shoulders. So I'm actually okay with that. We'll see how the year progresses. At first, I was all over Josh Hart starting, and I just love the way the team runs with him. And then I thought about it, and KCP had that pretty good game, and I thought to myself, Josh kind of tweaked his hammy, and I think coaches have so much more to think about than we do, and I think so many people get wrapped up in who's starting. When you're a coach, you have to look at the unit, right? I mean, it's Josh Hart to me. Is so valuable that he can either come off the bench or start. So why not bring him off the bench to start the year? Because I don't know if KCP handles coming off the bench well. And we need that guy to be good. If he's not good, Lakers are in trouble. Like, Josh Hart and KCP have to be good. So Josh Hart, I believe you can stick him with any unit. I really feel that way. And I think he's that good. I mean, I just love the guy. I think defensively, he's got this presence and this ability to play physical that nobody else has on our team at that position. So Josh Hart, I'm okay with him coming off the bench, and I wouldn't be surprised if he finishes. And that's really what it's about. For me, I used to fight with fans a lot on this because it used to just flood my timeline and I used to care. And then I just started to not care as much because to me, I never cared much about it as a coach or a player myself. It was more about me, like, I'm way more concerned about us finding a small ball unit that absolutely can roll people and finding the unit that finishes. And that unit that finishes being consistent. And when that unit isn't humming, we can stick a guy in and then it goes. So I'm more interested in that. Like, starting the game, I care about good starts, but LeBron starting, right?
Right?
Ingram starting. Like, put whoever you want around him, right? Like, let's go. I think Rondo's used to starting his whole career. So, why change that now? Let's give it 10 games and see how it looks. So that's kind of where I go on that. I hope I answered the question. I don't think about it too much, but Trevor, I do think about who's going to finish and certain lineups that I think will work together,
I think how you're looking at it is absolutely right in terms of looking at it as a coach would see it, because fans tend to not do that. We tend to look at it as, is player A better than player B, and whichever one is better should be the starter, right?
Yeah,
and that's not that's how it necessarily at. Works.
No, it doesn't.
So,
by the way, Iggy comes off the bench. Iggy exactly. was the starter. He was the MVP of the finals, right? Like Ginobili came off the bench,
right?
Yeah. It's Lamar end up coming off the bench, it's just things like that. I mean, I'm not saying, that's what these guys have to be, but I'm just saying it's really about who clicks together, and you got to give Luke and the team and guys like that time to figure that out. Right, Trevor? Like, you guys, that takes time. Like, maybe by the way, we're wrong. Maybe it starts that way. And by the way, after 20 games, he goes, you know what? We're better with Hart and Lonzo starting. I mean, who knows? So, but we gotta let it go run its course and figure that out as we go, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, that's the thing,
All right, guys, we're going to pause for just 1 second to talk about Wi-Fi. In my house, Wi-Fi is a big problem. I have a two-story home, and my signal is just never that great on my second story. I have to make sure that I'm downstairs whenever I'm working on anything, if I want to stream any videos or anything like that. It's a big issue. And I finally found a solution, and that is Eero. Eero allows you to set up a whole home network with multiple access points that allows you to essentially blanket your entire house in a great Wi-Fi signal. It has changed the way I'm able to use Wi-Fi in my house. And something that I really like is that they also offer something called Eero Plus, which allows you to block malicious and unwanted content across the entire network. It checks the sites that you visit against a database of millions of known threats, and Eero Plus prevents you from accidentally visiting malicious sites without slowing anything down. You can also block content, so Eero Plus automatically tags sites that contain violent, illegal, or adult content, so you can choose what your kids can and cannot visit right in the Eero app. It's very, very easy. Big thing for me, I have a two-year-old, and she is starting to use tablets, and she looks up Sesame Street videos and all sorts of things like that. And I want to make sure that she doesn't accidentally get into something that's bad. So this allows me to block any bad content from getting to her, allows me to protect my two-year-old. Eero also provides ad blocking, so you can get rid of annoying ads and pop-ups on all of your devices. And it also improves the load times for ad-heavy sites, so you can browse and stream faster than ever before. The single router model just doesn't work for our incredibly high bandwidth world, something I found out in my own home. It's simple physics, like light waves, Wi-Fi waves just don't go through walls very well. It's like asking a light bulb in your living room to light up your master bedroom, which probably just isn't going to work. Current Wi-Fi routers can be difficult to manage too, but the Eero app lets you manage your network from the palm of your hand so you know how many devices are connected at any given point, as well as the internet speed that you are getting from your service provider. You can also easily create and share a guest network. So when you have visitors coming in, like I do all the time, you can have them connect to a guest network, which is really, really nice. It's protected with a state-of-the-art WPA2 encryption, and because it controls the hardware and the software for your entire network, it ensures that you're always secure. Since traditional routers don't push software updates to their customers, they are left vulnerable to cyber attacks. Eero automatically updates, so you have not only the latest features, but the latest security all the time, and it's so important in this day and age. And if you ever run into trouble, Eero has amazing customer support. They were super helpful for me, helping me set everything up. Now, we have a special offer just for my listeners. If you go to Eero.com/nation, you get $100 off the Eero base unit and two beacons package and a year of Eero Plus. Again, just go to Eero.com/nation and enter that code nation at checkout. Definitely go check them out, guys. Again, Eero.com/nation. Been a big help in my house. Definitely recommend that you give that a look for your home Wi-Fi solution. And Gator, let me tell you something that I'm really excited about this year. I feel like this year, Luke Walton is going to be able to spread his wings a little bit in terms of the options that he's going to have available. Because if you think about what he had last year, you had Lonzo Ball, who's great at throwing the hit-ahead passes, just going warp speed. And then when he went out, you're going to Tyler Ennis. You're going to Alex Cruz, a different point guards. Rondo can play, not the same, but a similar style to Lonzo. So I think you have a little bit more consistency between the first and second unit in terms of style of play. And that gives Luke a little bit more flexibility to say, hey, you know, things aren't so quite clicking with the second unit. Let's slide Kuzma in at this spot, or let's move this guy up to the starting unit without having to worry about a group of five that sticks together, that's banded together. You can kind of mix and match a little bit more because of that consistency, I think, anyway.
Yeah. And by the way, what's wrong with, you're so spot on, but what's wrong with going, you know what, let's play one way with LeBron and Rondo and that starting group, and then let's bring in these young kids, just run things and run it fast and fast paced and tire people out and get up and down and battle, and then we come back in and we do a little mix and match and LeBron comes in with the kids and then Rondo, you know what I mean? Like, like that I like. Let's show different styles.
Yeah, and I think this team is designed to be able to do that. It's going to
I totally agree, man.
It's going to be so much fun. There's going to be so much to break down and analyze, I think, beyond what we saw last season, that I'm thrilled to get to do that. I guess I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the whole center issue. There's a lot of people right now that are, if anybody is concerned about something with the Lakers, it's that backup center position. What are your thoughts on it? I mean, I've got fans on my timeline nonstop saying, hey, we need to go find somebody. Go bring in Noah or bring in Emeka Okafor or whoever. Where are you at with all that?
It's hard. I don't want to pass judgment until I really see what's going on and where Mo Wagner fits and how Zubats plays and what Kuz looks at small ball five and all that stuff. But, you know, yeah, I mean, I'm with you. I think if I watch them in the preseason, I think the one thing they're missing is kind of a physical presence on that second unit. You know, I think we all use Brook Lopez as an example, you know, big body kind of guy. So that's the question mark for me. If I'm going to be honest, that's the question mark coming in. Where, you know, how does Luke and that staff and those guys get creative on lineups and how they take advantage of that, right? Because they'll have a disadvantage maybe using those big bodies, but maybe they can create one somewhere else, right? So that's going to be... as Luke would say, an opportunity. I call it a challenge, but an opportunity to figure that part out. You know, and then you hope that they're good enough shooting to win games. When you watch a team like Denver just light it up and teams like that, you know, you hope the Lakers have the shooting to be able to do it, right? So, you know, it's definitely, I think, the question marks that everyone's been raising is, you don't think that's a secret to the Lakers. I think the Lakers know the critique of their roster and what everyone thinks, but they have a plan and they have a reason and they have a vision. And man, they've been, listen, the front office to me and Luke together have all been phenomenal so far and gotten better every year, made great deals. You know, you get LeBron, you're able to shed some contracts, good trades, trades that open things up, and then draft picks have been great. So for me, it's like, got to keep going on trusting, right? I mean, you're not going to hit a home run every single time. I think that's what people don't understand. It's really tough just because you're Lakers. You can't hit a home run on every draft pick and every free agent signing and every trade. Can't be an absolute home run. But so far, they've done pretty damn good. So I can't sit back and critique it until I see it, right? That's kind of where I go with that.
Oh, yeah. That sounds almost exactly like what my kind of attitude was heading into the draft. I didn't know who they were going to take at 25. I didn't know who they were going to take with their second round picks. But after seeing them be successful in the draft for so many years, I thought, you know, you just have to trust them. And they're at that point. Yeah. We've seen Magic and Pelinka and the moves that they've made and Luke and the changes that he made last season. They're finding success. So just at this point, until they prove you wrong, assume that they are making the right move because they've got that track record behind them now, which is a very cool thing to say. Yeah. I mean, it was something that just a few years ago we certainly wouldn't be saying.
Dude, I'm 100% with you. I mean, it's like, that's where I think, I don't know, it's just a great point you bring up, because I think that's where, as you just mentioned, every conversation you would have with your boys and your people you work with, it was always, you know, what are we doing? What's the plan? And now you kind of trust the plan, whether you understand it or not, right? Like, now you kind of go, okay, we're rolling. Like, this plan's pretty nice. It's working. So I'm with you.
Hey, so Thursday night, the Lakers open up the season against the Portland Trail Blazers. Lakers Nation's going to be doing a big kickoff celebration and everything. Nikki K and I will be live streaming for that. But this first game, I think there's a little bit of a different tone because, of course, news broke a few hours ago about Paul Allen, unfortunately, passing away, the Blazers owner. You know, I think that adds a little bit of a somber feeling to the night. But what is it that you're expecting to see that evening?
I think it's going to be emotional for sure for Portland. Putting that aside, because, you know, obviously those are, you know, circumstances that are, you know, more important than basketball and what he's meant to the NBA and Paul Allen and, you know, I'm talking about in the Portland Trailblazers. When I look at just the basketball game and what my expectations are, I think it's gonna be off the charts. I mean, I think that place is gonna be absolutely rocking. They're a team that's been the playoffs four straight years. Those guards are such a tough cover. The team has been together now, so they're ready to go, and they understand that it's LeBron's first game in a Laker uniform. So it's like, it's going to have a championship feel to it. Obviously, it's game one, right? So it's not, but trust me, man, that opening night is going to have some juice like we've never seen before.
Oh, I think about...
And then Saturday, and then we're following up Saturday like, you talk about an opener. That home opener is going to be absolutely ridiculous.
It's going to be... James Harden in town, Chris Paul, right?
Dude.
Look, Lakers fans, this is another angle that I don't think a lot of people are talking about right now. Lakers fans don't have a whole lot of love for Chris Paul anymore after spending those years with the Clippers. He gets booed out of Dodger Stadium every time that goes there. Like, there's a lot behind this game that's going to be so much fun to watch.
So much. The Rockets were what? 1 3-pointer out of 27 in a row missed from going to the NBA final and maybe winning it. You know, Chris Paul gets hurt. They have got to be as hungry as a team has ever been. They know their window is right now. So I just can't imagine it's going to be anything less than just, playoff type atmosphere on Saturday. And Lakers, you saw what it was like in San Diego, right? And the first game at Staples, is out of this world. People that were at that Staples game, because we were in the studio, unfortunately I wasn't at that first Staples game, but it was like, the stars were out, people are around the court. I think people are going to be getting there early. That was just for a preseason game in September. So it's going to be unbelievable, man.
We're going to take a quick break to talk about your credit. Have you ever looked at your credit card statement and been shocked by the interest rate? Did you know you could actually roll all of your credit card debt into one monthly payment at a lower fixed interest rate? I wish I had known this when I was younger, because I wound up in credit card debt, didn't understand exactly how things worked with debt and interest and all of that. And I wish I had been better educated when I first got a credit card, because this can be a real lifesaver. Lightstream offers credit card consolidation loans from 5.89% APR with autopay. That's lower than the average credit card interest rate of over 18% APR. You can get a loan from $5,000 to $100,000, and you can even get your funds as soon as the day you apply. And I love this part. Lightstream plants a tree with every loan they fund. So you're not just helping yourself, you're also helping the world around you, which is such an important thing today. Now, my listeners will actually get a special discount on top of Lightstream's already low rates. But the only way to get this discount is to go to lightstream.com/Lakers. Again, that's lightstream.com/Lakers. Subject to credit approval, rate includes 0.5% auto pay discount. Terms and conditions apply, and offers are subject to change without notice. Visit lightstream.com/Lakers for more information. It's going to be amazing. And I'm sure you've seen LeBron has basically taken over LA Live. The giant billboards to LeBron on the sides of the buildings everywhere there. He's got the Beats one, the Nike one. It's like, this is going to be amazing when they open up against the Rockets at home. And then, of course, on the road against the Blazers, it's just the start of a new era of Lakers basketball. And it's so cool to be able to say that and be able to move into this new phase. It's no longer a rebuilding team.
Think about it for you guys, right? For me, we've been a part of this for a long time. And, we've all been, fans forever. And now we're grinding and getting through rough times and, getting excited over number two picks and, winning 35 games was a great feeling, all this stuff. Right. And then, now all of a sudden the greatest player on the planet comes and all of a sudden you're like, wait a second. It's no longer about, and by the way, I'm so happy. It's no longer about who's playing in the fourth quarter. Is D'Angelo getting enough minutes? Oh my God, what are they doing to his confidence and all these things? I remember going, dude, this is the NBA, dude. Like, what? Are you kidding me? Like, let's win games. So now we finally can forget all that stuff, all that crap. Let's lose in Phoenix so we have 3 more ping pong balls than they do. All that stuff. I hated it. Now it's about winning. Right? Like, obviously it's about building and the process. I've talked all about that, but you want to win games, man. This is like, you're trying to get to the playoffs and win. And we haven't had that in a while. So for all of us that cover it and all the fans, it's unbelievable hype going into the season and rightfully so.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, there's no more of that. Hey, oh, they won, but I'm disappointed because we wanted the better lottery odds, or they lost. Yay. And celebrating that, you know, that's all gone now. It's out the window. It's time to win. And gosh, it's going to be exciting to see again. Hey, Geeter, I know you got to get over to the studio before I let you go here. Prediction for those first two games, and for this, the opener and then the home opener, Portland and Houston.
Oh,
how do you think,
man,
the game plays out?
Oh,
I know. I mean, it's almost impossible to predict, but I'm curious what you think.
Brain, money, that all my money, my college tuition for my kids account, and I had to put it down. I would say 1-1 if you had to make me bet, but I'm going 2-0 because I can't think of anything else. So I'm going with my heart, and I don't care that rule that gamblers have, don't bet with your heart. I'm betting with my heart, and I'm going 2-0. And as you and I talked before we even got on the air together, we said, let's steal one in Portland. If we can get that first one in Portland, we're winning that Houston game, dude, because it's going to be going nuts. So that's how we get to 2-0. Steal that first one.
I like it. It's going to be such an amazing matchup because you've got a Portland team that's pretty much the same as they've been for last year, couple seasons. So they know each other. They know how to play together versus a Lakers team that's probably a little more talented, but they've got to learn how to play together. So it's going to be a fascinating matchup.
Here's the deal. When they go 2-0 and they win that Houston game, you, Lakers Nation, you immediately get on Twitter and say, Geeter predicted 2-0.
That's a deal.
Okay.
That's a deal.
That's a deal.
We'll tweet that out from the big Lakers Nation account.
And if they start 0-2, let's just not go on Twitter that night, okay?
Yeah. if they start 0-2, my computer's probably getting thrown through the window.
I've seriously had talks with like my wife and close friends about not being on Twitter this year, but I'm like, you know what, man, it's still part of the job and, you know, part of the fun. And, you know, I've come so far with it that, like, you know, from 7 years ago when I was first starting to do it and, you know, how crazy it was and battling with Jeremy Lin fans and stuff like that. Like, I feel like, you know, D'Angelo fans being mad at us and all that stuff. So I feel like
Anthony Irwin, right?
I've come a long way. I've really grown.
Trying to talk Anthony Irwin off the D'Angelo Russell ledge.
Anthony's one of my favorite
guys
who tweets. We always go at each other. It's so much fun. And then we side text and have a good time with it. But he I used to unload on him when he talked about Brandon Ingram. You know, he doesn't know what he's good at basketball. And then the next thing you know, he's calling him the next great thing. So I love it. That's what's great about Twitter, right?
Yep, exactly.
That's what's great about being a fan, man. You're allowed to have mixed emotions. And, you know, that's the beauty of it, too. The overreaction is fantastic. We all do it.
Sure can. I guess while we're talking about this, everybody needs to go follow Geeter on Twitter at Geeter3. Great follow on there.
Because I don't have many followers, do I? I mean, I don't know if I'm a good follow. I try to be.
I'm pretty sure you've got more than me. I know that. Let me see what you're at.
Hey, I appreciate you. I appreciate you pumping me up.
You're at
16,000. 16,000.
That's pretty 16 and verified.
Hey, I don't tweet that much. You know what? To get all those followers, you got to tweet so much, man. On every event, I can't do it, buddy.
I mean, hey, you know, I think what you lack in quantity, you're making up for in quality.
Thank you, my friend. You know what Twitter is for me? Huh. When I'm like, it's weird. It's like I could go 6-7 days not look at it, and then I'm watching a game, I'm at home, or it's a Laker game, and I'm feeling good, and I don't have a lot of work to do, and you know, at the moment, and I can fire off a few. It's like I don't know if it's binge tweeting, but I'll go on a run of like 4 or 5 in a row, right? Like that's kind of how I do it. It's like I'll either go all in, or you won't hear from me for a couple of days. So
I think that's okay.
I'm trying to get more consistent with this season because, you know, it is Lakers and it is fun. So
I'll try
to do better for you.
It's the Woj approach. When you do tweet, it's something big. It's not like you're just tweeting out random thoughts. So it's good stuff. It's stuff from practice. Like I said, it's the quality. That's what you're going for.
Thanks, buddy. Appreciate that. I needed to hear that. I appreciate it. Hey, man, I love coming on, and let's do it soon. All right.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much for taking your time on here, man. Really appreciate it.
Always, brother.
That's going to do it for today's show. Don't forget to go check out Lakers Nation on Apple News. Again, that is ad-free for the month of October, so make sure you check us out there. And head over to LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. And also, don't forget to keep it tuned to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Great source for all kinds of wonderful Lakers videos. That's going to do it for today. My name is Trevor Lane. You can follow me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane. Until next time, see ya.